to Fort Lewis Christian Church. A couple of quick notes about the worship. First off, this morning's choral anthem has been dedicated to Bill Murdoch. This is the song that they sung at his ordination in 1956. So, good memory there for Bill. If we have any visitors, if you could please fill out one of the visitor cards and put that in the offering tray when it comes around later on in the service, that would be appreciated. And now let's prepare our hearts and our lives for worship. Stand together for our opening hymn, I Am Light of the World.
Thank you.
sharing joys and concerns. A few updates. Ed Granger did end up having to go to the hospital last week, but he is back home. They've got the fluid off his lungs, and he's recovering. But continue prayers for Ed and for Helen. Prayers also for Betty Twigg, who was at Lewis Gale with the flu. Continued prayers for Barbara Hawks. It's good to have you back with us, Barbara. She's battling some blood pressure issues. Prayers for Carol Oliver, who had a CT scan this past week. Yeah, Terry?
Yeah, they found what the report says is one of the screws was kind of loose. Wait on the doctor to see what he says.
One of the screws in her back is coming loose and waiting to hear what the doctor says they can do about it. So the prayers continue for Carol and Terry Oliver. Prayers for Sydney Witt, who had cataract surgery on Friday. Michelle, how's he doing?
He's good.
He's good.
He said he had a back pain this morning. I don't know where that came from, but overall, doing great.
And prayers for Michelle, who managed to come back from Dubai just to come straight down
with
dad out. Continued prayers for Maddie Richardson. Maddie fell at school last Monday and fractured her tailbone, possibly, on top of everything else. Also, continued prayers for Nathan Richardson. Good to have you with us, Nathan. Doing well, but as he continues to recover. Joy that we served 40 folks at the Ram House yesterday. Thank you to everybody who went out and helped with that. And continued prayers for all those who are served by the Ram House. And a prayer request for Igor as well. Are there other joys or concerns to lift up this morning? Yeah, Jerry?
Continued prayers to Bob McCormick. And I got a call from my brother Jack and my sister-in-law. Rose has been diagnosed with spleen, stomach, and bone cancer.
So prayers for Jerry's sister-in-law, Rose Britton, who has spleen, stomach, and bone cancer. Others, yeah, Bobby?
Prayers for Mike Jones, our cousin who lives down in near Emporia. He was in a serious accident a week ago with a tractor that fell over a barn that fell on his hand, and he needs healing of his hand.
So prayers for Mike Jones, who was in a serious accident involving a tractor and a barn and his hand.
He was airlifted to VCU.
He was, had to be airlifted to VCU.
He's doing good.
Yeah, Carol?
I have a joy. We had three youth go to our house yesterday, and that was a blessing.
Had three of our youth go with the folks to the Ram House yesterday, so that's wonderful. Yeah, Harriet?
Tom Harris.
Prayers from Tom Harris.
Ed Moran. Buck Shepherd.
And Marvin Gallimore. Yeah, Sandy?
Peggy, she's battling cancer and going through chemo. Need your prayers.
Prayers for Peggy, who's battling cancer and going through chemo. Yes, McKenna?
Tanya and Haley Jackson, if I can remember their names correctly. They got in a really bad accident and they're all shaped right now.
Prayers for Tanya and Haley Jackson, who was a bad accident. Yeah, Betty?
Maxine Hance.
Prayers for Maxine Hance. Yeah, Kristen.
Connie Smith and Malone, she hasn't been good enough for a while. She's having back surgery this week, so
I'll pray. Prayers for Christy's mom, Connie Smith, who's having back surgery this week, has had some other health concerns as well. Yeah, Jerry?
Yeah, also continuing prayers for Doris Carter.
For Doris Carter. Others. Yeah, Ellen?
Blessing. We were able to clean up the blood drive on Monday. It was 30 units. Thanks for all the help and the people brought.
Yes, thank you to everybody who helped with the blood drive. We got 30 units of blood last Monday. Yeah, Ellen?
Sam Moore has a brain tumor, and Jim Hamilton, his kidneys are failing, and they're trying to get him moved from the hospital to a rehab area.
Prayers for Sam Moore, who's battling brain cancer, and Jim Hamilton, who's having kidney failure. Others.
Peggy Whitley.
Continue prayers for Sandy Whitley as she's going through her chemo. Yes, McKenna?
Brianna Warmay.
What was the last name?
Warmay.
Warmay? Prayers for Brianna Warmay. Other joys or concerns? Let's go together to God in prayer. Lord, we gather in this place, turning to you, the light of the world, that you might reveal to us who we are, who we are called to be, and what we can do to reach out to those we pray for here by name and to those who are in need of your love and of your help. Lord, we lift up those we have named here today into your care. Ed Granger, Betty Twigg, Barbara Hawks, Carol Oliver, Sydney Witt, Michelle Barnes, Maddie Richardson, Nathan Richardson, those served and serving at the Rand House, Igor, Bonnie McCormick, Rose Britton, Mike Jones, the youth who went and helped at the Rand House, Tom Harris, Ed Moran, Buck Shepherd, Martin Gallimore, Peggy, Tanya and Haley Jackson, Maxine Hintz, Connie Smith, Doris Carter, those who helped with the blood drive, Sam Moore, Jim Hamilton, Sandy Whitley, Brianna Warmay. Lord, we lift up those who have not been named aloud, but who you know remain on our hearts and in our prayers. We trust in you, O Lord, and in your care. We pray this in Jesus' name, as we pray together the words that he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Around this table, we are reminded of the sacrifice that Christ made for us to show us the way of love, the way of peace, and the way of the kingdom. We gather around this table to celebrate Christ's sacrifice that we might be emboldened to follow in his footsteps, to build his kingdom on this earth through love and sacrifice. Let's prepare for our time of communion as we stand together and sing our communion hymn, What Wondrous Love Is This?
Thank you.
was on the night that Christ was betrayed that during supper he took a loaf of bread. He blessed it and he broke it, saying, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take and eat of it in remembrance of me."
Shall we pray? Dear God, we are forever thankful that we have this opportunity to come together to take of this communion, to celebrate the great I Am, and for all the blessings that have been bestowed upon us. We are now challenged and charged as we partake of this broken bread from the remembrance of Christ's crucifixion on the cross, that we go forward with love and light and strong faith to make our world a better place. Amen.
It doesn't matter where we are in life, whether we've done a lot of good or a lot of bad. It's what we do with the next moment, what we offer of ourselves, of what we have been given by God, that determines whether or not we are part of his kingdom. There's always another chance to step into God's kingdom and help build it here on this earth. When we give in any way to that kingdom, we are a part of it. Let's receive our tithes and our offerings. How we want to participate in your kingdom. We ask that you bless them and bless us as as we seek to build that kingdom. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Scripture this morning from John's Gospel, third chapter, starting with the 14th verse. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their good deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Have I ever told you all about the time I almost burned down the church?
No.
Not this one. It was the last one I was at, I promise. But you worry about it. Yeah, I tell you that, and there are candles lit right behind me with my robe on. Don't worry, I can get it all quick. It was an Ash Wednesday service, and I had invited the congregation to come forward and write something that they knew they needed to let go of on a slip of paper, and I had set up a mixing bowl, metal mixing bowl with some tea candles in it, and they would drop the pieces of paper in, and the pieces of paper would ignite, burn up, and go away, and they very literally let go of what they were trying to let go of. The thing is the tea candles, once the wax got hot, melted, and the wax got to the bottom of the bowl. And each one of those pieces of paper, and most of them were apparently things that people were angry about that they wanted to let go of, so they had their own heat. They turned into little wicks in that bowl. And we had about 35 people there. And so we had about 35 little wicks in this mixing bowl, and all of a sudden, the fire started kind of consuming the whole bowl. And it got higher and higher and higher. Still contained within the bowl, but it got up to about this tall. There's a picture of it on Facebook. If you're friends with me on Facebook, you can go 6 or 7 years ago and look, and there it is. The fire was so impressive that there's a figure you can almost see dancing in it. Thankfully, our music director was quick on his feet and went back to where we got the communion ready, found a towel, wet it, and came out and put it on the fire, and the fire went out. I didn't burn down the church, it just left a scorch mark on the table that the bowl was sitting on. Why am I telling you this story? Other than the fact that it's funny. The church didn't fire me. They said, yeah, maybe we shouldn't do that next time. Maybe next time if we want to do something like that, we should think it through and not use the tea cans or something. Maybe some paper that burns up more quickly rather than cardstock that can hold on for a while. You want to know what I did as that fire grew? I continued the service as though nothing was wrong. Why in the world wouldn't I say, you know something, right now, I probably need to get this fire out more than anything else. But instead, I tried to pretend like, nope, this is all part of the plan. We meant to have a big fire. Nothing is wrong. As the entire congregation's out there like, here's the thing. When we make a mistake in front of people, do we like to admit it? Like, pretend like, everything's okay. I've got this under control. Completely and totally under control. In this morning's scripture reading, Jesus ends it by saying that we hate the light. That we hate the light because it reveals who we are. It reveals what we have done. It reveals the brokenness within us. It reveals so much about us. We prefer to control the narrative. Oh, no, I meant to do that. That fire was intentional. And Dwayne was ready with the water, the wet towel and everything. It was good. The more time I spend around Jesus, the more I realize he's okay with it when we mess up. As long as we own it. As long as we come out into the light and trust that we are loved enough. That even when we mess up, not to condemn the world, but to save it. But we have to admit we need saving. We have to come into the light and say, I need help. And I trust God to love me enough to give me that help. We continue to learn and grow, and I've stepped away from the candles to make y'all a little more comfortable. But I still have some problems with fire. On our Ash Wednesday service this year, we had these candles lined up. It wasn't these exact candles, because we had a few candles that didn't want to stay lit. And my temptation was to pretend like nothing had happened again. But I'm with people who love me, who have shown me light and goodness and mercy and grace. So I stood up and said, yeah, there was a candle in here about control. And so, of course, the candles didn't do what I wanted them to do, what I was trying to control. Because that's the way God works sometimes. And I was able to own the fact that, yeah, I didn't test the candles beforehand, and three of them had wicks that would not stay lit. They were, you know, maybe an eighth of an inch long. But when we show up, when we walk out into the light, we learn again and again. You're loved. 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 God loves us so much that he would send his one and only Son so that we could stand in the light and trust that though we are broken, though we are hurting, though we have messed up again and again and again, that redemption is possible and that God will handle our wounds gently, helping us to heal and to grow. Each week during Lent, I've been using a different scriptural station of the cross. And in this week's station, Jesus hangs on the cross. And there are two people who have followed him to the cross. Remember that in the story of the cross, everyone had deserted him. But in John's gospel, there are two people who follow him there, who stay with the light even in the face of the darkest brokenness and hurt they could ever imagine. His own mother and the beloved disciple. They come to the cross knowing that that is the light, and even though it seems like the light is about to be extinguished, they will be there in that light. And here's the thing, in the midst of the darkness and the brokenness and the loss and the hurt and all of the things that we might face in our lives, God's light makes broken things new. You know what Jesus says when he looks down and he sees his mother and he sees the beloved disciple? Does anybody remember? Here's your mother. Here's your son. He knits back together a family of care and of love because they stayed in the light. Their brokenness, their despair, their hurt, their hopelessness was redeemed, was made new. Mother, behold your son. Child, behold your mother. We try to hold up a facade of knowledge and wisdom and perfection, but in the face of the light, we are made new. We can only be smart and wise and perfect in the darkness. Our knowledge is always incomplete. And so when we step into the light, we accept that our own ways are not enough. Our own knowledge is not enough. But though our sense of perfection, our sense of control, our sense of wisdom and knowledge may be extinguished, when we step into the light, we are redeemed. We are made new. I want you all to take a moment. Think about a time when you learned you really and truly were loved. In the face of brokenness and despair, in the face of your own shortcomings, someone showed you unconditional love and accepted you. It was scary. It was hard. And it hurt. I guarantee you, if you learned unconditional love, all three of those things were present when you learned it. But it was worth it. Because you found redemption and light. It can bring a new life into us and into the world. That love is the love that we can know in God and we live within it every day, stepping into the light that we might be redeemed and renewed. Amen. If there's anyone here today who's not previously made a profession of faith in Jesus Christ, the one who redeems and shines the light of the world, we invite you to come forward and do so. If there's anyone who would like to join together with this body of Christ as we seek to live in the light, to share his love, we invite you to come forward and join with us. And if there's anyone who would like to rededicate their life to him, the one who renews and redeems us, we invite you to come forward and do so as we stand together and sing our hymn of invitation, Amazing Grace. Let's stand and sing. Know that God goes with you, lighting your way. might go shine that light of love for others. In Jesus' name, amen. Seated for our announcements. This week, tomorrow night at 6 o'clock, our elders will meet here at the church. So if you're an elder, please plan to be here and get that on the calendar. The over 55 group will be meeting at 9 o'clock Wednesday morning at Famous Anthony's. If you have time to come join us for breakfast, it's always a good time of fellowship. And those are the two big things going on this week. But we do have some other events. First, I want to ask Cindy if she wants to stand up and share some words about our Week Here Baskets.
We have done incredible so far. It's just amazing that when we put out this call, that everybody comes forward and gives financially and helps support our mission physically as well. We are good for all the volunteering dates except on Monday, what is the Monday? Monday the 26th, we still need people, able-bodied people that can help deliver these bags. That's a lot of work, and so if you can see me, please let me, if you can help, please see me and let me know. Thank you.
Thank you, Cindy. Just a quick reminder, 150 baskets we're putting together for the kids who are on free and reduced lunches in Salem and Western Rota County to feed them over spring break. Donations can be made today or next Sunday so we can finish filling up those bags for the kids to have food when that comes. All right, and now I want to make clear on a couple things. March Madness Bracket Challenge, this is a friendly competition. We're not gambling on this. There is no financial prize at the end of it. We do ask a $20 donation. This will help us with our general ministries, but it will also help us shave Donnie's head and his beautiful hair to make it today. But it's part of that Path of Samson challenge where he said either $5,000 raised and he'll shave his head or $10,000 raised, he'll shave his head and his beard. If you are interested in doing this, let me know. There is a link on here if you want to do it online. If you want to do a printed copy, I'll be in the office tomorrow morning, assuming the office is open and it doesn't snow 6 inches. But if I'm not here tomorrow, I'll be in Tuesday. I'll have printed copies of the bracket. The only thing is you got to get your entry in by noon on Thursday, and you can donate your $20 and you can put it. You can give it to Bobby Morris back there. You can give it to me, and I'll give it to Bobby. Or you can make the donation online via Givelify. It's a friendly competition to build a little bit of camaraderie and encourage a little bit of trash talk. That's okay. Just remember that most of the time it's won by somebody who picks their favorite color to go all the way. It doesn't take a whole lot of skill. So if you're interested, or if you have any questions, let me know. Are there any other announcements? Yes, Gary.
Would you like to mention
the journey of prayer?
Yes.
I'll say something about it. You can do it next week.
Okay.
On Saturday, March 31st, Holy Saturday, the Saturday where we remember Jesus' death and him laying in the grave, we will have another journey of prayer here at the church. There will be 6 stations set up. We'll be open from 10 to 4. You can come anytime. You can take as little as 10 minutes. You can take as long as an hour. If you can help set up on Palm Sunday, March 25th, that's 2 weeks from today, we'll start setting up after worship that Sunday, and we'll also be setting up some throughout the week. So if you can help set up, or if you can help take down, that's March 31st at 4 o'clock, we'll start taking everything back down. This is a wonderful opportunity for us to take some time on the Saturday we remember Jesus laying silently in his tomb. prayerfully remember what he offered to us. So if you can come by and take some time on that Saturday, plan on coming out, I think it's going to be a very redeeming activity. Yes, Jerry.
Yeah, those of you that are golfers, on April the 20th, the Salem Kiwanis Club is going to profit the Challenger Little League. And many of you know Challenger Little League. Sid and Sydney Witt started Challenger Little League. They need a lot of effort and money they need to continue to do programs for these children that have a chance to play baseball like other kids do. And so those of you that that are golfers, come see me, and I'll get you, next week I'll have some applications for you where you can get a team together, or if you have a sponsor or have a business that you want to sponsor for us, we appreciate it.
So if you want to help out with the Kiwanis Golf Tournament that will sponsor the Challenger Little League, which is for special needs kids that get the opportunity to play baseball together, talk to Jerry. Yeah, Bobby?
Okay. You all know I am a big sports fan, and there are a lot of DT people in here, and there are a lot of UVA people in here. So let's challenge each other. Let's make this a family against a family. Because it is the fun, and it's a way to put more money into our cause for this.
All right. Y'all get out there and give them help.